Good evening, and welcome to Dead Air Live. Tonight, on the first show of 1995, we're going to be reviewing some excerpts from 9 of the shows that we did during 1994. It has rather become a tradition over the last few years that the first show of the year is a look back at all the shows of the year before. Some years, we've sat down and edited pieces together so that we can introduce the piece and have a representation of every show of the year. This time, what we're going to do is we're going to have everybody in the group introduce a segment of a show, or in a couple cases, somebody will introduce two, because there are members of the group who have left the group since the beginning of last year, and there are people who are sick tonight. So in the course of the evening, you'll meet all the current members, almost all the current members of the Somerville Producers Group introducing tapes. My name is Larry Yeager. I'm hosting this segment and introducing the first tape, which is a segment of the 20th anniversary edit. This year was the 20th anniversary of Dead Air Live, the longest running public access show in the country. And in celebration of that, we not only did a show, we also did an hour-long edit, you know, an edited piece that was 60 minutes long that was shown on SCAT. And this first segment will be just a like 5-minute piece of that tape. And let's watch it.
Most of the early ones are gone because we didn't have the budget to save the tapes, so they just got recycled.
I'd like to see live, right here, right now.
We're doing it. Well, what were we saying? We're saying how little production went into this show. But you know, in the old days, we used to do a show every week, whether we had one or not. I mean, it was Dead Air Live, and it was, you know, Dead Air, and we turned on the cameras and did a show. It was a funny time. It was a funny time. You know, the show started out as a radio show, mm-hmm. but on TV. Like, it was Dave, and the three people who started out, David and Barry and Charlie Kelly. And Dave Bigley used to sit in the studio and play records, and that was it. You know, and he would, you know, talk about the records while he played them and stuff. And then that gradually evolved into a talk show where he was the host and he had guests come on and talk about other things.
Hi. My name is Dave Bigley. I'm here at, well, never mind. I guess where I am. I'm here to tell you about what Community TV Week is all about and what the Channel 3 Producers Group is all about. First things first, Community TV Week, no, first things first, the Channel 3 Producers Group is about a year and a half old. It's a core group of people in the Somerville community that have been working in and around video for a while. We've been producing programs for the public access channel here in Somerville that you're watching right now.
Do you see this, doing this show and working in the group as an opportunity to expand on some of your own personal experiences and share them with other people out there?
Yeah, that's pretty good. I guess it's part that. I'm also a photographer and I do some writing. Mm-hmm. And I used to be in theater. And long ago I realized that the most fun that I've ever had is when people all gather together and they have to make something happen and it has to have a deadline and has to go on.
Okay, gang, we have to produce this meal.
Huh?
We're on TV. This is real. We know it's real because it's TV.
What's this cinema
theater?
Right here?
Well, only TV.
I know it's true. Oh, so true. 'Cause I saw it. Coming on the little screen. The creep had passed, the old men laughed, and all the girls screamed. 'Cause four guys from England took us all by the hand. It was time to laugh, time to sing, time to join the band. hit the moon and covered up the sky. They built their bombs and aimed their guns, and still I don't know why. The domino tumbled and big business roared. Every night at six, they showed the pictures and counted up the score. I know it's true, oh, so true, 'cause I saw it on TV.
Everybody needs education. All the little people need education. Eskimos and papers need education. Even Aboriginal need education.
Stop laughing.
And the public access channel is in Davis Square in Summers.
Hi. The next segment is going to be a music segment, a song called Walkin' Blues by Robert Johnson. It's going to be performed by a street musician who's in Harvard Square very often, named Mark Minton, who plays blues acoustic guitar and sings. And he brought along at the last minute his roommate, Rob Rude Boy Rudin, who plays percussion and was a big hit on the show. So, you know, this was one of my favorite shows, a show I produced. My name is Dave Leskovac, and, well, let's see it.
This is an old Robert Johnson tune. It's called Walkin' Blues. This morning I was feeling around for my shoes. You know by that I got these old walking blues. Woke up this morning, woo, feeling around for my shoes. You know by that now people got these old highway blues. Brooks run to the ocean, ocean run down to the sea. Don't find my baby, somebody gonna be. Ocean run down to the. And I'll find my baby people. Somebody gonna be burying me. Going down to the racetrack, gonna see my pony run. He's the best in the world. That horse is a running son of a gun. Going down to the racetrack, who gonna see my pony? I lead this this morning had to ride the blinds. I've been mistreated and I feel like dying. I leave this morning, ooh, had to ride the blinds. Say, I've been mistreated, ooh, and I can't help but cry. From her head down to her toes, break it on a dollar, most any old where she goes. Got elegant movements, ooh, from her head down to break it on a dollar, almost any old where she goes. I good morning had to ride the blinds. I've been mistreated and I feel like crying. This morning I was feeling around for my shoes. You know by that I got these old highway blues. Woke up this morning, ooh, I was feeling around for my shoes. You know by that now people got these old walking blues. You know by that now people I got these old highway blues.
Hi, welcome back to Dead Air Live. You're watching a retrospective show of some of the things we're proud of from 1994. And that was Walkin' Blues from a show Dave Leskovac produced. The tape we're going to see next is from a show produced by ex-member Lucius Small, or I should say on hiatus member Lucius Small. And the show was entitled Plutonium is Forever. And it's about one of the subjects we like to talk about a lot on Dead Air Live sort of over the years, if you've been watching the show, which is the danger of nuclear power and nuclear weapons and what a lot of issues crop up around the use of nuclear items. So we're going to watch the beginning of that show, which details some nasty things that happened in relation to Three Mile Island. So let's take a look at that.
Went door to door down this street, and this street is, there is Three Mile Island right there, and there is
right.
Unit 1 in operation
right.
With the steam coming out, and you found cancer up and down the street, you said?
Right.
Every other house?
Right. Yeah. Sometimes, some of them were two in a row.
Really?
Yeah, we used a medical history sheet that Dr. Carl Johnson helped us with so that we could ask the proper questions. We tried to find out if they were contacted by the health department, many of which were never contacted. We found out whether they evacuated, and if they did evacuate, where they evacuated, how long, when they came back, all of that.
Jane Lee found in her door-to-door monitoring this 600% increase in cancer from before and after the accident. Do the people here think that this evident increase is connected to Three Mile Island?
Well, you know, it's pretty quiet now. I think Jane can understand. She probably knows this, too. They don't talk as much anymore about it. But I think it's on everybody's mind when there's cancer and so forth. I someone dies, I think TMI's brought up right away.
Yeah.
I think it is up here in the hill, I know. Because we had a lot of deaths up here.
These are the deaths, the cancers and the cancer deaths that we discovered in the very rural area where we found a 600-fold increase. This particular area here is a development of 500 homes. And in that 500 homes, we found 45 living cancers right here, 23 cancer deaths, which was a total of 68. We found 53 benign tumors, 39 thyroid problems, 209 people with respiratory problems. A lot of people complained of respiratory problems following the accident. This area here was where we just took all the pictures where there were many, many cancers. This is an elevated area up from the plant. This here is elevated and this is elevated, way up in the air, so that whenever they had the accident, the radiation hit the mountainside and it just kept hitting the mountainside, and those people, many of them died very quickly. These are cancer deaths and leukemia deaths. The ones with the exon are the leukemias, and the ones with the black and the white stripe through are cancers. These were living cancers. These are just the people who brought suit against the company. These do not by any means include all of the cancers.
Quietly, Three Mile Island's owners have given cash settlements, some as high as $1 million, to the families of those who died or had children born with birth defects as a result of Three Mile Island, like Debbie Baker.
I had a child that was born exactly 9 months after the accident that with Down syndrome. So to me, it's we are victims.
How far did you live from the plant?
We lived about 5 air miles from the plant. It was in a development that was sitting on a hill. So it was about 5 miles.
What do you think of Three Mile Island? What do you think of what it's done to you and what it's done to your family, what it's done to so many other people?
I think what it has done to us is it's taken our voice away. In other words, every time that we're affected by things that they do at the plant, there's nothing really that we can do or say that's going to make a difference. So I think that's how it affected my family the most. We don't have the right to voice an opinion. We don't have the right to speak up for things that are harming us.
You grew up in this area?
Yes.
Your folks lived in just a few miles from the plant for many years?
Yes, they lived 3 miles from the plant.
When Three Mile Island was first constructed, I mean, how did you feel about it being built and then being turned on?
It didn't bother me. It was like it's always been there. You know, it just never, ever bothered me.
When did it begin bothering you?
After the accident. To have that happen to a person, an accident affect your entire life. You know, I mean, when the accident happened, we were informed of the accident 3 days later. To me, it was like my whole family's going to die because I knew radiation killed you, I knew radiation caused harm, and that was my extent of what radiation did. So to me, we were all going to die, and I think that affected me the most. But I didn't really start really researching it until after my son was born.
And what did you learn?
I learned that our government covers up many, many things. I think what bothered me the most is I was always the most patriotic person. You know, if we had Olympics and I seen our flag, it was fantastic. I was such a patriotic person. But what I've learned is that the government has a way of covering things up, and to me, I think it's just shocking. It's just, that hurt the most.
Why? What do you think it's been covering up issues involving nuclear power?
Because if they don't cover it up and they realize what the extent of radiation, what it does to people, we would never have another nuclear facility. But as long as people did not die exactly at the time that accident happened, they can always get away with saying nobody died from a nuclear accident. And that's not the truth.
If you go to Three Mile Island...
Welcome back. That was an excerpt from Plutonium is Forever, one of the shows, rather, from our 1994, the year that was, here on Dead Air Live, and one that we're particularly proud of, produced by Lucia Small. The next excerpt you're about to see is from a show I produced called What Should Be on SCAT. We thought this was an interesting topic based on what had been happening in Somerville regarding a flyer that had been seen around town denouncing SCAT for being intolerant of the majority by airing a program aimed for minorities and other special interest groups in the community. And we had a rather heated discussion here in the studio, moderated by Laurel Greenberg, who did an excellent job on that show. And that's pretty much the preamble that you would get in the beginning of the show. So let's have a look in at that discussion.
Bear with me. Okay, you should be on the air. Hello, who are you?
Yes, hi, this is Stephen Van Valkenburg, the spokesman for Concerned Citizens.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi. I'm just calling to clear up any misconceptions anyone might have. The Concerned Citizens has been and will be a community advocacy group dedicated to the promotion of public cognizance. I guess you could say issues, complaints, topics, concerns. They originate from individuals in the community. We just act as a catalyst for these people and ideas. And I guess you could say at the forefront of our concerns is the perpetual promotion of homosexuality, which it seems that SCAT facilitates. The consensus among those that we've had informative dialogue with is that SCAT disproportionately, they represent the so-called gay community in disproportion. And I'd be happy to field any questions that anybody might have at this particular point in time.
Okay, I'm glad you called in. I think we're all very glad that you called in. Please stay on the line. What we're trying to get at here is the purpose of public access and letting everybody, have a voice. I understand what your flyer was about, but there's sort of a discrepancy between sort of silencing some part of the community instead of sort of getting your side, just to simply come on and, voice your own opinion. And that, should we be censoring anyone? And that's, I think, is what people got so irate about your flyer, was that it seemed like there was one part of the community that was trying to silence another part. Does anybody else have a comment?
I just want to say, if we can quote the flyer directly, Steve, or whoever penned this flyer used the phrase dead in its tracks. And I want to know what exactly you meant by that, by stopping gay programming dead in its tracks, and also calling it a promotional tool of gay behavior, which you call a disorder, and I'd like to know where you got that information.
That's a wonderful question. The information comes from the fact that humans are not born gay, and that's of immense importance right here, because that's at the root of this conversation. Dr. Dieter Steinberg and Dr. Krieger, both of Germany, have conclusively shown that homosexuality is not an intrinsic orientation. I think a gentleman by the name of Dr. Richard Cohen of, I think it's Seattle, Washington, he also came to the same conclusion. Now, our point was that SCAT disproportionately represented the gay community, nothing more, nothing less. We wanted a little more parity in its programming.
And my question was, what proportion would you be happy with? No gay programming at all? I'm not too clear on that.
Well, that's a good question. To bog oneself down in quantifying.
Well, how many shows on SCAT are
gay? Let's ask Abigail.
That's what I'd like to know.
Let me address your question, because I think it's a very good one. To bog oneself down in quantifying the so-called gay programs relative to the non-gay
programs.
You're
the one who brought up proportions.
That basically just gives us a proportional ratio.
Yeah, you're the one who brought it up.
Which in its very essence really means nothing. What's important, though, is the net effect of these programs in the disinformation it disseminates to our youth. Our youth is already trying to swim their way out of this homosexual propaganda that they're inundated with. So in that sense, the net effect of SCAT's programming doesn't coincide with Somerville's demographic background.
Well, all right, Steve.
Nor does it represent the status quo of Somerville youth, I might have.
Okay, let me interrupt you for one second. Let's ask Abigail about, she is the director here, so let's talk about the programming and how much programming is on, and should programming even represent exactly how much percentage is in the community, et cetera. Okay. Go ahead, Abigail.
We have between 50 and 60 hours a week of programming on SCAT every week, and it runs the gamut from many fundamentalist religious shows, is the highest proportion of our programs in 8 languages, including English, and programming as diverse as the Americanist Perspective, which Steve brings in, and Pride Time, which we saw a clip of earlier. I think the point of SCAT is that since SCAT itself does not produce programming, but we act more as an agent or a resource or a medium for the community, that our job is really to encourage as diverse a representation as possible of the community to come in here and make use of the resources and make use of the channels. So we really cannot and will not, and I believe it would be unethical to stop a significant proportion of the community from speaking. Our real task is to encourage people in the community to speak. And Stephen, when you came in, when we found you putting up flyers and said, you know, Stephen, you know about SCAT, you know you can come in here and make your own programs, you said, I don't have time. So I think it's really incumbent upon you, if you feel that your views are not being represented, for you to get your group of people together and make your program and make your views heard. And as you know, we would do, you know, everything that we can to make that possible for you, just as we do that for any group in Somerville.
Abigail, you say...
Good evening. My name is Steve Sherblom. I'm going to show you an excerpt from a show called Men, Trauma, and Violence that we produced in October. In this program, we explored issues of gender socialization, male identity, and men's violence. During a one-hour discussion, our guests illustrated connections between relational abilities such as empathy and ability to nurture, self-awareness, interpersonal skills, and being in touch with your emotions, and an ability to be in safe relationships, whether that be friendships or lovers. In the second half of the show, we talked about violence prevention programs that work with youth. But in the segment we're about to see from the first half of the show, Karen Crinsley and David Lisak offer a psychological critique of gender socialization and men's violence. Let's look at it.
It makes them more prone to be perpetrators.
Well, I think if you look at the ways that they're socialized, this is an overgeneralization, but typically little boys are told to not show their feelings, that, you know, real men don't cry, that, you know, if you're upset, you hit something, you fight back, whereas it's okay for little girls to cry. That's feminine. A little boy who cries is not a little boy. So they're taught that any kind of feeling of distress needs to be held in. The only legitimate way to let it out is probably with anger. And that's very dangerous, I think, for our society.
Mm-hmm. So if we could somehow legitimize other ways of dealing with these feelings, that perhaps there would be less violence?
Well, I think what we need to do is return to thinking about men and women, girls and boys as human beings. And I think if we just don't tamper with what human beings are endowed with by virtue of being human beings, that we'd be a lot further ahead than where we are now. I think the problem with the socialization patterns that we have evolved over generations and generations in this culture and most cultures around the earth is through socializing male and female human beings into masculinity and femininity, that we end up truncating these individuals in fairly complementary ways. But it's as though we take the human universe and divide it in two and say people who are of one sex can live out one half of humanity, and people of the other sex live out the other half. And that's handicapping everybody, men and women, and it has particular effects on men and particular effects on women.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in the kind of work that I do, I work with men who are stereotypically sort of the most masculine. These are men who've been in the military. In many cases, they're men who've not only been in the military, they've been in combat. And I talk to them about not just their combat experience, but their early childhood experiences. And one of the saddest things that I hear is when you start talking to these very sort of typically macho men about being little boys and the first times that they were very injured and they were in great distress, and the message that they got was, you are not allowed to show this. And if they showed it in any way except anger and fighting back, they were rejected either by their parents or by their peers. And that message, that lesson that they got, stuck with them, and then it was reinforced over and over again. It's reinforced in high school, and then once you go into the military, I think that's kind of it. That's the icing on the cake, the military, mm-hmm. and then combat. So if you talk to people about their very early experiences, I would agree with David, you don't hear that much of a difference with little boys mm-hmm. and little girls. It's only as they are, you know, influenced by society, things start by their family, by society, it changes.
You're saying you don't see a difference with the way boys and girls experience early trauma or early distress, their emotional state, they recall the early emotional states tends to be the same?
I'm not even talking about trauma at this point. I'm not mm-hmm. talking about childhood physical or sexual abuse. I'm just talking about simple, early, upsetting experiences, you know, being punched by the class bully on your way mm-hmm. home from school or something like that, something mm-hmm. that typically happens that I wouldn't call necessarily a trauma. It's pretty upsetting. And that the way that you need to react when you're very young is very set in stereotypical ways. You know, a little girl, it's okay for her to run home crying and mm-hmm. be hugged. That's not necessarily okay for a lot of little boys.
Mm-hmm.
And people are afraid of making their sons into sissies or something mm-hmm. like that.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of developmental research at this point that demonstrates that, first of all, through the first year of life, male infants are actually more emotionally expressive than female infants. And through the first several years of childhood, the differences between girls and boys are less pronounced. They become more pronounced, and it depends obviously on the family of the children and their environments, how rapidly and how harshly they're being socialized.
Mm-hmm.
But the differences that Karen is talking about are sort of cumulative, and they're gradual. And you see, if you observe children, you actually can see this process of socialization each year getting more and more severe, and the effects becoming more and more pronounced
mm-hmm.
to the point where by the time male children reach the age where they're really now more involved with their peer group
mm-hmm.
In school, in playgrounds, the peer group becomes a very powerful socializing influence
mm-hmm.
because by now they all know that to be real boys, to be boys, they have to act in certain ways
mm-hmm.
and they socialize each other. And they socialize each other in fairly cruel ways, some ways a lot more cruelly often than most parents would socialize.
Uh-huh.
So the problem with changing socialization patterns is that they are so embedded uh-huh. in our culture that you're not only talking about trying to convince parents to think of their children as human beings, not as boys and girls,
uh-huh.
but you're talking about changing cultural norms uh-huh. That are really pervade the culture, pervade the media, pervade everyone.
Uh-huh. And let me make one thing clear. I think that boys and girls are different. I think that men and women are different. I don't think that we should try and make men become women and that people should be exactly the same. But I think a lot could change in terms of socialization, and it would be okay. In fact, it would be a lot better. I told you that I was working with a group of men who were all substance abusers and ex-cons, and at one point one guy got up and said to me, I was trying to get them to talk about their feelings, uh-huh. about what had happened to them. One guy got up and accused me of trying to make them all into women
uh-huh.
because I was trying to get them to talk about their feelings.
Uh-huh.
And what I think is just so sad is that he was really serious
uh-huh.
and everyone agreed with him except me, of course. And the fact is that just something so actually harmless as talking about your feelings,
mm-hmm.
in fact very, very helpful, is seen as threatening. You're trying to make mm-hmm. men become something, you know, not masculine. Mm-hmm. That's really frightening, that, you know, to be a man means
mm-hmm.
what feelings are okay, anger's okay, happiness is okay, but other mm-hmm. kinds of feelings really are not.
Thanks, Steve, for producing that pertinent and meaningful show. And now for something completely different. Hi, my name's Laurel Greenberg, and one of the shows that I produce here as part of the Somerville Producers Group is called The Barry Mackerel Show. It's a comedy variety show. It's hosted by Barry Mackerel, who I'm sure you all know, and his sidekick, Paul Leonard. We have a variety of guests on the show. We really seem to drive the local talent out of the woodwork, as it were. And a clip that we're going to see tonight is from the most recent Barry Mackerel show. It just aired a couple weeks ago, in fact. And it's a little skit that we did that was performed live here in the studio. It was sort of had sort of a holiday theme. So let's join Barry and his guests for this little clip.
Woo! Nice shoes! Look at our shoes! shows of fun. Now the jingle hop has begun. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. Jingle bell time and jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing in Jingle Bell Square. In the frosty air. Go gliding in the one horse lane. Giddy up, jingle horse, pick up your feet. Jingle around the clock. Mix and a mingle in the jingling feet. That's the jingle bell rock.
Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. Jingle bell chime and jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing. In the frosty air.
What a bright time. It's the right time to rock the night away. Jingle bell time is a swell time to go gliding in the one horse lane. Giddy up, jingle horse, pick up your feet.
Hi, thanks for enduring that. And now, what I'd like to introduce next, in place of a producer that can't be with us tonight, is a show that was produced last February about home health care here in the state of Massachusetts. Lucia Small produced the show. She's taken a very small hiatus from the group. But nonetheless, she worked very hard last year, and this was one of the shows that she worked on. It has to do with, as I said, home health care and I think Medicare, and how sometimes Medicare doesn't pay to the proper people it should pay to. So I did see the show, but I'm not an expert on it. The segment we're going to see, I believe, is a taped segment from the show that was hosted by Sarah Ann Shaw here in the studios, and it has to do with an Alzheimer's patient and how his family is, how her family rather is dealing with her condition, and how the home health care people in the state got Medicare to kick in some bucks and help pay for the situation. So I don't know if the tape is cued yet. Okay, the tape's not cued yet. So let's talk about your New Year's resolutions. No, now the tape's cued, so we don't have to get to that. You're off the hook. So let's go see this tape about home health care from a show that was produced by Lucia Small. Roll it.
Has Alzheimer's, we're going to look at how her family got some advice and got some legal advocate to help to get her the benefits she was entitled to.
I didn't even know what the word Alzheimer's was at the time, but as it progressed, you know, and people kept saying to me, you know, she may have Alzheimer's, and I said, nah, that, you know. This is just old age, you'll get over it, you know. And it went on and on. But she really, it's just like somebody falling apart. She, everything she'd done so good all her life, she just stopped doing it, you know.
My mother got sick and has Alzheimer's, which is a very sad story in itself. But after a couple of years, she started getting worse, and my father needed some in-house services. And we tried to find some extra help, and there isn't much extra help to find unless you really go looking for it. And we got a hold of the Old Colony and the Rockland Visiting Nurse, and they put in a nurse's aide to help him out for a year or two before my mother's condition worsened.
Doris was, scheduled to go from the South Shore Hospital to a rest home at the time by Dr. Backman's recommendation, and if she couldn't be taken care of at home.
Everything seemed to be fine after we got the services and the Medicare was paying for it for 2 or 3 months, and then Medicare decided that in South Carolina that she wasn't in need of the services.
Mrs. Allen's care required me to get her out of bed, put her in the wheelchair. She couldn't go in the bathroom anymore, so we had to start bathing her in the kitchen, and she'd stand up, and I have special handles on my sink she could hold on to.
I got a hold of Karen Nixon at the Southeastern Mass Legal Association, and she sent us some paperwork, and we filled it out, and they wanted to see if we had a case to go get an administrative hearing in Boston. And she called me back about 3 weeks later and said they would like to take the case and represent us.
As a Medicare advocate, I represent Medicare beneficiaries, people who have been denied their Medicare coverage. For the Home Health Campaign, what we do is represent people who have been denied home health coverage. We have always done that, but with the campaign, we've been trying to reach more people who have been denied their Medicare coverage, have not been able to have home health coverage. Rockland Visiting Nurses Association was aware that we were really trying to encourage people to get Medicare to pay for their home health services. And so they contacted me after we had done a training in which some people from the Rockland Visiting Nurses Association had attended, and said that they thought, based on what we had said at the trainings regarding what could be covered if you had Medicare, that Doris Allen should be getting Medicare coverage, and that she had several visits that were denied. I believe a total of 44 at that point were denied, home health aid and nurse visits. At that point, because Medicare wasn't going to pay any longer, they were going to have to private pay, and under private pay, they were going to have to cut down a lot of the services.
Me and Mrs. Allen were working. We used to pay on our income, even with the kids at the end. We were paying $10,000 or $15,000 a year in taxes out of our pay, and Medicaid and Social Security. And then when we needed it, we got you know what.
The reason she got the Medicare denial was because they said that the services were not complex, and that she was receiving unskilled services. However, in her case, what made the services skilled was that she was being observed for an unstable medical condition, and her condition could go downhill if she were not if her condition was not being observed.
Part of the nurse being here, to being paid, was they were in here helping my father, training him how to take care of my mother, whether it was walking with the handrails that we put up all over the house, or to change her.
They had to train her as well as her husband in terms of how she was able to walk, use of a posy belt in sitting in the chair, and when she was walking around the house. Sometimes if she was having a problem in that area, or if what they trained her to do or taught the husband to do, and if it wasn't working out because Alzheimer's is a deteriorating condition, they had to adjust what they may have taught the husband maybe only a week ago. She also had some sort of a problem with her lung capacity or with her breathing. Her lungs had to be listened to because she wasn't able to just say, I'm having a problem breathing, or I have a cold today, or I have bronchitis, because of the Alzheimer's. So certain medical conditions which maybe wouldn't have risen to the level of being skilled or needing skilled care, they became needing skilled care because of the Alzheimer's.
It worked out in the end, but only because of the right people who represent you people out there. And you people should not be afraid to go looking for help when you need it.
So I think this really strengthens, as well as I think it bolstered the Visiting Nurses Association. They were less timid now to go ahead and go out into that area, and that they shouldn't be so afraid of Medicare, and they shouldn't be so intimidated by their denials.
I think there's justice for the little people, but you got to know how to get represented, because if my father had to go out and pay a lawyer to do all the legal work and everything, it would end up costing them $10,000 just to get into court.
And I'll tell you one thing, if you ever have to go through putting your wife in the nursing home, you really want to have something to think about.
It's very scary when you got to come in the house and you have to watch your father cry for someone that never cried all his life in front of you. And the whole system is wrong because the people need help. They can't wait 6 months to get it.
Hi, welcome back. My name's Denise Taylor, and the next tape that we're going to show to you is an excerpt from a live studio concert that we aired earlier this year. The musicians performing are John Medem and Jeff Song. They are local musicians. Both of them studied here at the New England Conservatory and are now Asian improv recording artists. They've put out two CDs on that label. And in this piece, John Medem will be playing percussion. Jeff Song is playing a Korean instrument. It's a floor harp. And they'll have special guest Dean Lobbs on trumpet. The whole piece is entirely improvised, and let's look at the tape.
You didn't learn this at the conservatory, did you? Okay.
Thank you. Hi, welcome back. My name is Thomas Danielczyk, and I will be the host of the last little tape segment of this show. As Larry already mentioned in the beginning, and as most of you already know, last year was the 20th anniversary of SPG, and so we had a 20th anniversary party. And we, of course, there were a lot of former members of SPG, and we shot a tape of interviews with some of the former members. That's going to be our last tape. And is the tape cued? I guess it is. Okay, roll the tape.
Cable in Somerville. He did the original first show of any citizen in Somerville.
My father asked me to go film my brother playing hockey at Somerville High. I was just working with my brother and some friends, and we did a thing called Rock Bottom Productions.
What do you think has kept this together so long? How can you explain that 20 years later we're here with all these people?
It's a great thing. Public access. There's equipment. It's cost. People can afford to do it. All people have ideas.
I think people like to demystify media, and I think that's why I got involved. I hated the control thing of television, and it was a way to get back and have your own voice. And I think people get inspired by that and say, hey, I can say something too.
Very interesting people who are very involved in terrific causes and who are committed to a real sense of community in a pretty remarkable way. And it just seems like this group is a testament to community memories, I think, and that's pretty amazing given that this is 20 years of sort of compilation in Somerville. It's great.
The first show I ever did was George Washington birthday show, where they had Bobby Watson. I don't know if you know the history of Bobby Watson, but he's a skeleton dressed up like George Washington, and we had a woman dressed like Marilyn Monroe, and she was singing Happy Birthday, similar to like Marilyn singing to Kennedy. It wasn't my idea. I didn't produce that one. I just thought that was like, I mean, I'm doing the film chain. I'm saying, wow, this is a strange group. I think I joined. This is like.
Carol, hi.
Hi.
I'm Barry. This is Paul.
Hi, Barry.
You know us from a long time ago.
Yes, I do.
And we understand that you've been involved in the producers group for some time, or used to be involved.
Yes, I was. It's really been an important experience for me, really. I was first interviewed as a guest on Dead Air Live.
And you were interviewed by whom exactly?
I was invited on the show by Claire Beach to talk about a peace walk to the Soviet Union that I was on, and the women's peace movement in Europe.
And this was such a powerful experience. Walking through Europe, you see a lot of what happened in World War II. You can see the reconstruction. You can see churches were left that are bombed out as a memorial to what happened in World War II. And you can feel that the people in Europe really fear this situation, that their land is going to be the stage for a nuclear war.
I was so impressed when I was interviewed on the show by the whole commitment and the concept of collectively producing the regular political programming for cable TV, that I was just drawn into it. And
it's a powerful medium, Carol.
And the idea, the idea that you could get the skills by rotating around, from everybody got a chance to work at every position, and I really appreciated the commitment that everybody had. You had to be there for meetings, you know, the show had to go on, so you had to be there. In the 80s,
everybody had to work at every position tonight as well, because we did a rotating show. This has been the 1994 retrospective for the Somerville Producers Group and Dead Air Live. Thank you very much for watching. Continue to support us. As I said at the head end of the show, we put on 24 shows last year, and hopefully we'll be well into the 20s again this year. Thank you for watching, and good night.